Dear colleagues, on behalf of the team of the Academic Breast Cancer Center of Excellence, John Martens and I will give this presentation. And John Martens is professor in translational cancer genomics, and me myself, I'm a surgical oncologist and clinical epidemiologist. Well, on behalf of the team, we'd like to share with you our ambition, which is to provide added value for individual breast cancer patients, meaning the best achievable prognosis and the highest possible quality of life. And our clinicians and researchers together, we strive for the study and implementation of innovative treatment strategies and diagnostics, to discover genetic and environmental risk factors for breast cancer, to predict treatment response, to improve surgical interventions, to limit radiation-induced fibrosis, to study the evaluation towards drug resistance, to exploit the immune system therapeutically, and also to improve quality of life. And our clinical tasks are to bring together the necessary expertise for patients that need it and encourage care as close to home when possible. So the patients that come to our center can see us as professionals that offer weekly, regional, multidisciplinary team meetings and also weekly outpatient joint clinics, meaning a clinic together with a surgeon, a radiotherapist and an oncologist, but also clinics together with the surgeon and the plastic surgeon. We do second opinions. About 30% of our new patients concern second opinions. And we do complex surgical procedures together with thoracic surgeons and plastic surgeons. Patients are being treated within 42 clinical trials. So it means we have a tertiary breast cancer care and screening service. So for breast cancer cases, we provide specific care. That's what we call the tertiary breast cancer care. For example, for women aged 36 years or younger with breast cancer, young women with breast cancer and the wish for conservation of fertility, or pregnant breast cancer patients, also when heredity plays a role. We also give care in patients who need complex diagnostics, locoregional recurrent breast cancers, oligometastasized breast cancers, T4 or N3 breast cancers, or male breast cancers. And there are also the patients with brain and leptomeningeal metastasis, patients that need autologous breast reconstructions, sometimes in a direct way during their treatment, and treatment within the clinical trials. It also means that patients at risk for breast cancer are also treated or followed in our center. For example, after nodal field radiation or after total body irradiation due to the lymphoreticular malignancies. And also when heredity runs due to familial breast cancer or due to a proven gene mutation. So delivering this tertiary breast cancer care and screening, we are aiming to offer this care in a ratio of 80 to 20 tertiary versus non-tertiary care. And our center aims to have a leading role in regional research. So when we do innovation, then we'd like to transfer it towards our regional partners and do this in a repeatedly manner. For example, the value-based healthcare, the value-based breast cancer care. This is supplied by Citrienfonds Regionale Oncologie Netwerken, and it means that we collaborate with the 8 regional hospitals mentioned at the slide, and we perform this value-based healthcare, which means that we use patient-reported outcome measures in the consultation room. And we do it, all of us, and are now in the phase that we have so much data that we can do benchmarking and try to augment our quality of care. So this leading role in regional clinical research means that as from 2016 on, we have 375 peer-reviewed publications, PubMed cited, and also have loads of PhD candidates. And the innovations in care in recent years are many. And some examples are diagnostics on, for example, the fast PET scanning and the 3D ultrasound, but also on plastic surgery, the lymphedema surgery, and the direct autologous breast reconstructions in younger women, also within their treatment. The clinical genetics department with the emergency testing for BRCA1 or 2 gene mutation carriers. Radiotherapy, the protons and the partial breast irradiation. The nanotechnology with the thermolabile doxorubicin, preclinical studies. And medical oncology with the therapeutic drug monitoring. But also for the future, we aim to do much research, for example, on neoadjuvant radiotherapy treatments, prediction of radiation fibrosis and cardiac toxicity, and also the prediction of secondary tumors after radiotherapy. Concerning the value-based healthcare, we aim to introduce this also for the metastasized breast cancer patients. And we aim for a continuation of phase 1 and phase 2a studies within the drug development center. And also we want to orchestrate a so-called nurse-led clinic within the regional hospitals for patients at high risk for breast cancer. And also we do a lot of translational research. And this part of the presentation will be given by Professor John Martens.
So my name is John Martens. I'm a professor in translational cancer genomics, and I'm responsible for the translational research in our ACE. And this is actually divided into six different topics: prevention and early prognosis, pharmacology, innovative diagnostics, tumor immunology, and innovative treatments, and also machine learning to improve our understanding of the different data we generate. With regard to prevention, we would like to identify risk factors, so in which we can predict which patient will get breast cancer, but also we would like to develop breast cancer de novo, so we really would like to rebuild a cancer from scratch. And also we study genomic changes which are involved in the early progression, because these are very important, because we can still prevent the disease from being metastatic. Pharmacology is very important because we need to know what drugs, how the drugs are we treat with are metabolized in the body. The innovative diagnostics is also very important because we want to give the patient the best treatment. Tumor immunology is an emerging field, and I'll come into detail that a little bit more, but it's very important to also improve the treatment with regard to tumor immunology. Innovative treatments involve theranostics, where we use radio labels, which can be used for imaging, but at the same time for treatment. And also we try to understand mechanisms why combination treatments work in certain patients and not in others. And the machine learning is very important because the amount of data we generate these days to get all the information which patient benefit from necessary, we need computer science. And this we do together with TU Delft, for instance. So now I give you a few examples of the kind of research we do. And the first one is about ex vivo assays, where we use patient material to diagnose whether a functional activity in a cancer is lacking, and which we then can target with a drug. And here specifically, we can measure DNA repair deficiency. So if a patient can make, in response to irradiation, certain foci, we can measure this and we can identify a small subgroup of breast cancer patients which actually cannot repair DNA properly. And these patients are very sensitive to PARP inhibitors. And actually, this assay has been developed before. But we now do a study, which is called the Future Trial, where we do this study in patient material. So these patients with metastatic disease, we take a biopsy, we irradiate the biopsy, and then we read out whether the patient material can make foci or not. And if the patient cannot make those foci, we will treat the patients with a new PARP inhibitor in the clinic. And so this will lead to the first, I think, in vivo experiments where we can predict whether a patient will respond to treatment or not based on an ex vivo assay. The other thing we do is drug metabolism. So also with even already long-term use drugs like tamoxifen, they are not optimally metabolized in individual patients, and we'd like to understand why that is happening, and that's why we do pharmacology. The same is also for new treatments. We would like to know why certain patients have a much higher dose than others, and therefore we do therapeutic drug monitoring in individual patients to understand why this is happening. And also, what we also do here is do interaction studies, like with other substances patients take, whether they affect a response of a certain drug or not. And apart from that, we do cost-effective studies to optimally, based on pharmacological results, to optimally treat the patient. So another thing we do is we look in the blood of patients, where we can also do diagnostics in the blood of patients, and we have machinery to isolate tumor cells from the blood, and we can characterize those tumor cells. Specifically, we can even these days culture them, and which means that we can do drug testing. We can do those functional assays, which we can do on biopsies, also on tumor cells from the blood, and we can molecular profiling of tumor cells from the blood. And here is just an example from three patients where we have molecularly characterized individual tumor cells, and we clearly see that these three patients are very different, and we will see what the future will bring, how this is relevant for the response of the patients to the treatments given. So apart from tumor cells, there's also fragments of the tumor DNA in the blood, and that's also used as a molecular diagnostics, and we have developed even within Erasmus MC specific assays which can really measure the biology using DNA in the blood of patients. And here is just as an example for patients predicted to have brain metastatic lesions. When we measure whether there's tumor DNA present using this assay, we can stratify the patients which will do very well from those which do worse. So we have a very special trial in the Netherlands where we also look for whether a novel drug combination, which is a CDK4 inhibitor, which is given in combination with hormonal therapy, whether this is best used in the first line or in the second line. But in this same trial, we do liquid biopsy research, so we collect blood samples from those patients and use our assays to determine whether a patient will respond to the treatment, but also to study whether the patient, which gets resistant, to study the molecular markers which tell us which patient will not respond any longer. So we combine an innovative trial with liquid biopsy research. The other thing we can do is even scan the whole genome entirely, and also there we get very interesting information. For instance, in breast cancer, we can divide them in three groups. One of them, which are patients with indolent disease, they have very limited of mutations, and there are two other groups, one which are double-strand DNA repair, which have a particular mutational pattern, and a third group, which is this APOBEC mutated breast cancers. This is a mechanism which is turned on automatically, and these patients have lots of mutations, many more than patients with indolent disease, and not surprisingly, we see this group much more frequently in aggressive breast cancer. But not only for the biology, we also have specific treatment for these three groups. So the DNA repair deficient breast cancer are probably sensitive to PARP inhibitors, as we've seen before. But also these APOBEC cancers, they are probably very sensitive to immunotherapy. And also the APOBEC cancers have PIK3CA double mutations, so they are probably very sensitive to a target which... So alpelisib is a novel drug. It specifically inhibits this kinase, so these patients are probably very sensitive. So based on the molecular profile of the cancer, we can also stratify patients and treat them the best way we can do this. And not only the complete genome, but also individual driver genes we identify, and there we can individually also target patients for treatment. So this information is very useful for the patient to give the best optimal treatment. And then the other thing is immunotherapy, which is really a booming field. Not so much in breast cancer yet, but we think that we can improve this because we can take leukocytes from the patients and put specific receptors which target the tumor cells in those cells and then give those T cells, which have then been genetically modified to specifically target the patient's tumor and improve the treatment. So we really develop which are the right receptors we need to do this, and also we do this already clinically, so we can treat patients using this strategy. So we cannot do this alone, so our ACE is not an independent in the sky, so we actually collaborate with a lot of other ACEs, like the ACE on DNA repair, in which we developed this in situ assay, but also of course with the gynecological cancers, because there's a lot of connection between breast cancer and ovarian cancer, which is related to the hereditary component, because these patients do get both kind of cancer types. The ACE pharmacology and also the ACE immunotherapy, obviously we work together with, but that's within our Erasmus Cancer Institute, but within the Convergence program we work together with TU Delft, of course, and also on the national level for clinical studies we work with consortia like the Boog and DRUB, and also for finding risk factors in genetically hereditary breast cancers, we have a collaboration with international consortia like BKEC and SIMBA. So translational research you cannot do alone. For specific research questions, we collaborate with the different institutions in our institute and nationally and internationally. So this was the translational research, but besides translational research and patient care, we also do education. And for this, I give the word back to Linetta Koppert.
Transfer of knowledge and education is reflected by the participation of team members of our ACE in national guidelines, diagnostics, screening, reconstruction, systemic treatment, national guidelines, but also participation in NABON breast cancer audit, borstkanker onderzoekgroep, Dutch oncology research platform, hereditair borst- en eierstokonderzoek Nederland, and international consortia. And also a few years ago, this book was published called Borst Vooruit, edited by Agnes Jager, oncologist, and Paola Veenstra, oncology nurse. And also, there's this education yearly going on in the medicine curriculum, the master and the bachelor, also the minor program, and the training of residents at all departments, technicians and nursing personnel. There are elective courses in nanobiology and education at the skills lab and education within the master's clinical research and health sciences, and also within the summer program value-based healthcare. And also we have PhD students in molecular medicine. So to conclude, the Academic Breast Cancer Center is acknowledged Center of Excellence for Hereditary Breast Cancer by NFU VWS in 2015, and the re-registration is going on right now. And also our ACE is member of the European Reference Network Genturis for Hereditary Breast Cancer. And the ACE is motivated to continue providing excellence in patient care, as well as clinical and translational research, as well as within education of our future professionals, meaning therewith to add value for individual breast cancer patients and those at risk. And this is a slide with an enumeration of our team, which is far from complete, but it's very important to mention that this collaboration forms the pivot and the driving force for the Academic Breast Cancer Center. And Jill and I really want to thank you for your attention.